Boy, you're welcome.
To the barber shop.
You're welcome.
To the barber shop.
Barbershop Podcast, episode number 190. A mighty impressive, incredible number, Ryan Cannon.
It is. It sure is.
Yeah, so much has happened in 190 weeks. And they say if you can make 10 episodes, if you want to do a podcast, you do 10 episodes, you're doing better than 80% of other people. So that be your lesson in life. Take it in bite-sized pieces and chew it and digest it a little bit, but keep chewing on it, and eventually you're going to eat that mofo. Barbershop Podcast from Box O Studio in the shadow of the great Hamilton Mountain, your source for real original music, real original musicians, independent only in the sense that they are not necessarily assigned to a multinational record company or a deal, but in every other way are world class. People who you may have never had the opportunity to come across, and we do you the service of introducing them and showing you why you should care and a little bit about who they are. And so next time you see their name, you think, I really like that show. They sounded great. I think I'll go out. And you'll support your live music venue, because this music is not made in a factory. It's not made in a laboratory. It comes from the heart. It is a healing thing. It is a real thing. It is not about the money and the fame, because that kind of is a self-filtering aspect of the business. The jerks and the tools and the dickwads, they all kind of get bumped upstairs to management, but the musicians themselves tend to be some of the greatest people in the world, and it's a great pleasure to have them every week here on Barbershop Podcast, as is having Ryan Cannon and Gary Greenland. You guys do a great amount of work. We got a different musical setup in here every week. A lot of times you have no idea who it is. It depends if they filled out our form site. Sometimes it's kind of, sometimes it's easy peasy.
I knew tonight's guest, though.
You do tonight's guest because you couldn't forget, because we had just gotten the Mighty Apollo 16 before she came in, because it was right around the same time we did the Varga 100. So I know you were like episode either 99 or 101. It was right
101.
Around
101. 99 was Century Club.
So yeah, let's not talk about that. No. Do not look at episode 99 ever. Okay, so episode 101, that would be a Mighty 89 weeks ago. We had tonight's guest on Barbershop Podcast, and so much has happened in that time. She was already mercurial. People were talking in glowing terms about her. She was a bright light in this town, and in the time since then, so much has happened. I know for sure she's been more than happy to work with me on some of the little projects that I've done, called up, and was always available, always gracious. And the band of brothers that she's brought in tonight are wonderful, world-class people. We managed to tip a couple together and humanize the whole experience. And she's in tonight, Laura Cole. Great honor as usual. Thanks so much for coming in.
Oh, thanks for having me.
Yeah, it's been a wild 89 weeks, hasn't it?
I can't believe it. Yeah. Wow, it seemed like yesterday.
And the math is so easy this way for us, right?
It's very
all
true.
It all comes
true.
Around. So that means we're only 10 episodes. We're 10 weeks away from 200. And it's a neat,
Congratulations.
Thank you. You know,
it's
for a long time, Ryan and I were just, we saw it as this little thing that we kind of did. And then you start getting feedback from not all only all over this city and region, but you know, the world, where people pick up on it and appreciate the kind of authenticity that we deal out of this place. Barbershop is more than just a tag on my name for men who don't often talk about their feelings. It has always been one of those places where you went in and the truth was dealt. The barber, it was his place, it was his show, but it wasn't about him. Right, he didn't sit there talking all day about what the barber was. A lot of times, you don't even know who this dude is. But he asked questions. He was a therapist, and the rest of the men would sit there, and the boys who were learning how to be men would sit there, and you would listen as this person was probed, and answer questions in an honest fashion that they wouldn't normally tell anyone, let alone five strangers. But they were all together, and then throughout the day, it would filter through with the customers in there. So this is a very similar thing. It's a music show, but it is a talk show. It is about music and why music's important and who those people are. And they tend to be funny, interesting, and full of great music, which is kind of great for me every Wednesday. As I said, I get free therapy. So anyway, last time you came in, you brought pretty well this same setup. You had Bucky Berger on drums. It's not that funny. A little bit.
We're not used to it. It's good.
It's good. I like that.
And Chris Chaircos, your sweetie pie and an amazing bass player.
Thank you, man.
And your dad, Ron Cole, who's one of the coolest dads. I've got daughters, and I hope I'm as cool as Ron when nice. They become, like, you know, adults. And you've brought this fellow in with you, Harvey. So tell me about who we brought in as our special guest tonight and what your connection is.
Yeah, well, Harvey actually found me about, 2 years ago now?
Yeah.
Right when we released the Papi No single with Daniel Lanois, which is something that was, you know, kind of made on the spot, you know, that's that type of project. Harvey really took to it. And really loved my voice and essentially just messaged me on Facebook and asked if maybe I'd consider singing on his record. Mm. And maybe, you know, collaborating on a couple tunes and stuff like that. And so when time came for us to do this record, I decided, well, Chris and I have been writing amazing songs for, you know, since we've released Dirty Cheat till present day. So I figured, you know, I think Chris should really come on this journey with me and experience what I'm going to experience with Harvey. And I can't believe how amazing we all gelled together once we got to England.
Right.
It was incredible, and you never know what to expect.
And you have to let go and trust. And clearly, like a tenant of a relationship, there's a lot of good dudes who would be dickwads who wouldn't want to do this, who would always think about ulterior motives. But when you're a musician and you're connected with somebody, you see opportunity.
For sure.
Obviously, there was something what made it worthwhile for you to believe it and respond to it. What was about him that you liked? You obviously checked him out, right?
Yeah, of
course.
Was it
songs? Or?
Of course. You know what? I Googled Harvey, and I couldn't find much because of something in his past, which he'll probably tell you about. He worked under a pseudonym for a while.
Oh yeah.
I know that was because of something that went wrong.
But
a security breach.
Yeah, a publishing issue. So, you know, but I still found. Now my mom does Reiki. My mom has her master's in Reiki, so she has always been very into Reiki music and stuff like that. So I played her these tracks, and she immediately just, you know, got an amazing vibe. I got a really amazing vibe, and I'm kind of a vibe person. You know, I work off that a lot.
Yeah.
And I mean,
your gut's going to be with you and be increasing in size your entire life, so you might as well make friends with it. It's just the way it works for all of humanity.
Yeah, I mean, how can you not trust your gut, right?
Yeah,
I mean,
have to. If you're an artist, especially, right?
Oh, for sure. And you know what? I've always been keen to accepting opportunities that I feel have, you know, a chance for me to explore my musical horizons and to work with other people and collaborating with Harvey and Chris and another writer, Helen Weeks, was just amazing. It was so impactful.
And it kind of right off the bat, it started happening, right?
We literally got off. We flew in. We got off the train. Chris had left his laptop, camera, everything on the train. So we were like, we had a nightmare day.
Nice
and
start.
We show up at the studio and we started writing this song, I think.
Straight off the bat. Really.
Yeah, right as soon as we kind of sat down and
no
met each other.
No screwing around.
Yeah,
right
we
it.
Just got right to it.
We felt so comfortable so quickly.
Yeah.
So I have to ask Harvey, how did you become aware of Laura Cole?
Well, I've always liked the work of Dan Lanois, and I've had this idea about this record that I wanted to make for a long time, which looked into and explored different styles of music that I really like, but don't suit my voice. And I never found the singer I was looking for. It needed to be someone who could really deliver soul and honesty and grit and have great talent. And it would be great if that person could co-write as well. And I was looking at Dan's site and I saw this Papineau sing and heard Laura singing and just completely blew me away. So that would be perfect. That would be amazing. So
you had
Facebook,
a couple of drinks in
I thought,
you.
What's the worst you can do? Yeah,
I mean, stalking, like, stalking,
exactly. A little bit stalky, a little bit stalky, but you know. Yeah. I thought, what's the worst you can do?
So, yeah. She's too far away to punch
you, hairy,
me, right?
Weird English, whatever. So I chanced my arm and Laura said she'd like to do it. So we just made plans.
You did it.
And man, it was amazing from the very beginning.
Great.
It's very rare to work with someone and write with them and gel that instantly. But to do that in the way that we did and write seven songs, one after another, that easily, really. And every one of them's on the record. Everyone was a keeper kind of thing.
They all felt great.
Very rare.
And I often ask, how was the delivery when you're talking about a record? Because sometimes they're breached and they come out sideways and it's very painful. But this sounds like it was a beautiful experience to record, right?
Absolutely. Yeah. And I mean, we all didn't know what was going on. You know, we didn't know if it was going to be something that was kind of awkward or anything like that, you know. We had obviously never met each other, and I mean, we did have that incident right before we did actually meet you, but I think honestly writing that song right when we got to the studio, it kind of calmed all of our nerves. It got us in the groove right away.
The bottle of champagne helped as well.
And I was going to say, what were you drinking? What wasn't I drinking?
You remember that.
That's the thing with champagne.
Well done. All right. We're going to get all sorts of little insights about how it went down, but let's start with some live music because there's no need to explaining what you can explain so much more eloquently in the reel. What are you going to play for us first?
We're going to start with our tune called Shooting Star.
Shooting Star, is there anything you want to tell us about it, or is it self-explanatory?
On the record, it's actually
a dub tune
with accordion.
And saw.
Nice.
It's my first
a
credit.
A singing saw.
Yeah, it's my first credit on a record besides singing.
Oh, wow.
Playing saw.
Well, you're going to hear it. You're going to hear it right now. Live on barbershoppodcast.com.
Search for the truth. Plan. world is a world. You are who you are. You only have so long to wish on a shooting star. As jagged hearts may stab and snap, you'll always be there to bring good.
So good. Each and every time, Laura Cole, another great find out of Hamilton, Ontario. You can reach this music. You can go and support it. There are going to be links at the end of this episode where you'll go and get her music, get the whole catalog. What's the point of just getting one song? Get them all. Yeah. For the price of a, you know, of a, God knows, I don't want to use Tim Hortons as an example. It's more expensive than my car payments, I think. But music, people, you know, I'm old enough to remember doing crappy jobs to buy music, right? Doing sweaty, ugly jobs so I could buy music and go to music. And it seems like it's either the venues don't exist, the kids can't get into it, there's not that love affair that happens when you're, you know, starting to become a individual and a human on your own. And music has become free and disposable and marketed like sugar candy, right? Yeah. But I was talking to this last night, a couple Generation Y people on the cusp, right? And I'm Gen X. And understanding that, you know, everyone got laid and had happy times in 1946, 1945, when the war is over. That's why all those rock stars were all born, 45, 46, 47. And they have this huge base of influence. And then the people born in the early 60s and 70s, before there was money to pay for kids and the kind of a security line there. And there's a lot fewer people, so less influence, less people being targeted, and that's why that generation didn't really identify. Now you have the millennials, which is a 30-year swing. And yes, there's inane music, you know, there's like electronic music and there's video games and distractions, but there's a lot of them. And there's a good core, a huge good core of people in their 20s who love good, authentic, original music, and that will be the salvation of music. It won't be from anyone in my generation. They've stopped buying new music in their 30s. They stopped looking for new music in their 30s. But the internet, for all the things that are wrong with it, is great because it's an access, right? You can find the music. So let's talk about just even in the last 89 weeks, you know, what's, you know, what are some of the things that have happened? And let's say that there's 50 weeks in a year, so we're talking 1 3/4 years. What's kind of gone on in your life?
I'm trying to think if the record was released when we did this last time, was
Dirty
it?
Dirty Cheat was either just out or you were
just out.
Or you gave me an advance copy.
It was was just out.
Yeah.
So since the release, we've obviously, you know, claimed 5 Hamilton Music Awards, 4 the record as a whole,
yeah,
which is really incredible. I mean, you know, having that support from Hamilton, having grown up here and
right,
trying to, you know, been trying to do that my whole life. And it really was amazing for us to be recognized for something that we just did out of love, mm-hmm, you know. I'm just so glad that people liked it.
Yeah, and then you started traveling, which was nice, yeah, because you got to do the festivals and got to get the exposure, and that's all part of the business. I'm going to gloss over you for a sec because I want to talk to Bucky, because he's a man who's been in the business for a long time. And you've worked, one thing I found, if it's Andrew Aldridge on guitar or you on drums, like someone who works with a lot of female artists is invariably with the tastiest guy in the business, who doesn't step on toes, who can play his instrument with empathy and consideration, but still with confidence, right? It's like they want, like they like their men, right? It's like, I want that to be an M-A-N man. I just don't want him to be a douche, right? So with you, what is it about her? And talk about some of the other female artists you've played with, for starters. And then, yeah, what is it about her?
When you're playing with female artists personally, it's really about, you know, their voice, and it's about them, you know, doing their thing. You can't be in the way. You have to sort of try to, I guess, wrap around it. With Laura, she seems to have really good time, and you know, so whenever I'm off, it's perfect because she pulls us back. She's got also natural pitch, which makes things really, really easy to get the vibe of the song. So yeah, it's
a bit of a revelation, because you get a lot of stuff put in your inbox to right, check out, right? Because yeah, you played. So who have you played with?
I'm trying to think who I've played with. Mainly Laura, and yeah, with a band from Heaven, yeah, not just I mean, years ago, I played in a wedding yeah, band for.
But you just have always liked, because, and I'm going to say this because we get a lot of drummers in here, and they can ruin it in an environment such as this. Right. And someone who has the control to play with, like not loud, but with confidence, right, and on the edge of the beat, and not be too loud, that is a very rare thing. And a lot of times, yeah, you'll have to go to a softer stick, a fire stick, or brushes,
right, yes,
because you can't even play. Mm-hmm. Were you someone whose parents would punch him if he like played too loud, and yeah, you just had to learn how to? Like,
no, I mean, you just have to pull back, you
yeah,
know, because you allow a lot more room for other things, for vocals and other instrumentals to play through, right? Mm. So drummers always make the mistake of playing way too much,
yeah,
too much, too many times, and too loud and too quick. And
well, the pocket's so gorgeous. You know, I gotta say, Chris, you've always, like, for a bass player, and when the two of you play together, the pocket is a beauty thing,
yeah,
right?
Nice.
And Ron being a melody machine, mm-hmm, you know, over here, are you like a noodle king? Is that like your thing?
I play hooks and lines. I don't just
yeah,
play chords. Seem to somehow end up doing that type of thing, and playing accordion on this is the first time.
It's for me, because that's, you know, I watch the episode mostly, and the accordion is key and featured, and I've had keyboard players play the accordion, and it's a struggle. It's like they have a brand new baseball mitt that doesn't, you know, open and close very good.
Well,
and there's a lot of stress
and
grunting.
This is really my first instrument, so
yeah, and you can tell. So I'm saying there's an ease in yeah, when it slides in the arrangement. And you know, Harvey, like for you as a guitar player, it's kind of nice to step in and going, oh my goodness, I'm not like have to go through fighting the fucking guy on the mountain with the guitar ego, right? There's no yeah, one really right now who's doing what I'm doing when I'm vis-a-vis making, recording this record.
No, I mean, this is beautiful to me.
Because you know the way it can be, right?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely, yeah.
Like, guitar players are awful.
I know. I know.
I am fucking worst.
Yeah, absolutely. No, I mean, we've done shows in several different formats. Back in the UK, we had quite a big band, and then over here, we've had a slightly smaller number, but we've had electric guitar. We've had Mikey playing with us at some mm-hmm, shows, and we've done all these different formats. And so this that we're doing tonight for you is unique as well. We haven't played with quite this set of instruments. And
probably,
it makes it fun, because every time it's a different take on the songs, you know.
All right.
It's
well,
makes it interesting.
It does.
The CD is called Human. People can get it on your website. On your website, that's the first place you want to go, because the artist gets most of the dough.
Oh, yeah.
If you have to get it somewhere else, get it there. Yeah, harveysummersmusic.com. check it out, featuring Laura Cole. And like, the stuff I heard with Pearly Jenkins, I just loved it. Like, you're awesome in that. Yeah, because you have it's a rare thing when someone can sing with somebody and not dominate them, but have a voice that's absolutely unique and remarkable and strong. Like, how do you do that? How do you resign yourself that I'm not just blending in, I'm actually singing, but I can't take away from his song? You know, I have to support it. And you have a gift for that. Like,
oh, thanks. Wow. Yeah, I just found, you know what, with harmonies, I sing them a little bit different than when I do sing lead. I sing them a little bit more airy and just complimentary to the main vocal. I learned a hard lesson once doing a recording where they didn't use my background vocal because it was I don't know, it was probably just a little bit too much power for a backing vocal, essentially, you know. Now it's just I've humbled myself a bit. I think I can slip into some background vocals.
Oh, my goodness. And a counterance for the song. There's a, you know, a yin and a yang that happens in every song. Either you're conscious of it or you're not, but there's a tension that has to occur. And it happens. We're going to play one off of the CD. First one is Make Your Mark. Anything you want to tell us about this song? It's Genesis or...
Yeah.
Feel free to plead the fifth on any of these.
I was just going to say, you did get to hear a beautiful range of Laura's vocals as you were talking about that on the record, because she does sing songs from very soft and airy up to... so loud and powerful, she was 6 feet away from the mic to record it. So it is a really nice record to hear the amazing range that you have with your voice.
Sure. But and I sing harmonies.
And you sing
harmonies. And you sing harmonies, which is multi-tracking.
Yes.
I think the world of the studio. Yeah. Nice little taste of it right now. This is Harvey Summers, Laura Cole, Human, with the track Make Your Mark on barbershoppodcast.com.
What you started and tread waters uncharted. There'd be no telling of what you could do if you'd reach full potential and not be so cynical. Wouldn't be the failure you're used to. If your heart is always in it and you keep your commitment, this could be a walk in the park. You shouldn't be so lazy, but your room stays hazy. You're a flint without a spark. A sun that doesn't shine, a moon that doesn't rise, a flame that doesn't light up the dark, a bell that doesn't ring, a song no one can sing. It's about reciprocity. With unfulfilled potential, you're bruising your credential. Enough of your hypocrisy. A sun that doesn't shine, a moon that doesn't rise, a flame that doesn't light up the dark, a bell that doesn't ring, a song no one can sing. Enslaved by your stress.
too much, but who am I to judge? At least I'm the one who's striving. If you weren't so lazy and covered up those ladies, you could be the one beside me thriving.
Barbershop Podcast. Amazing music every Wednesday night. Implore you to like us. Like, what's not to like about us? Why wouldn't you follow us? Like, we're not saying follow us to the ends of the earth. You know, we're just saying follow us. And with YouTube, subscribe to us. Over 64,000 people have viewed, and we got like 350 subscribers. Those are the people who are lucky enough that every week there's a new show. It pops magically into their feed. Like, for you. You don't even have to go digging for it. It's like, do it. You know, that's the little bit of gruel that we get here, telling us that we're doing a good thing and that we're good boys. We're doing it for the right reason. And the reason is, in a world that's eating boxed, frozen, freeze-dried, tasteless garbage, we have a mama's kitchen going on here. And the real home cooking that comes through here is something wicked. And I guess I could go through and you could all talk about why you're in music, but I think it's obvious, right? You need a raison d'etre. You need the reason, like, you're not just in it to suck air until you die. Let's just talk, though, quickly. Talk quickly about songwriting, right? Both of you seem to understand that, you know, for me anyway, if you have the ability to make great analogies and you have a connection with the spirit and the mind, you almost owe it as a songwriter to write about that, to do your little bit to progress a society. I wanted you to talk about conscious writing. Like, do you get vis-a-vis, I want to write about something important? Does it have to happen to you, or can you just write about something that's that you're passionate about?
I think I can write about something that I'm passionate about. I mean, even if it's a situation that I've helped a friend through, for example, I mean, I can actually, you know, draw on that, and, you know, I obviously know how they feel in the situation because I will be there to help them through it. So, I mean, that's something that I can definitely write about. When I do consciously write, when it's like when we sat down that first day, I have this little notes page on my phone where I write every single one-liner that I think is funny or witty.
Could wrap something around.
Yeah. Anything that's, you know, even a tiny little sentence that is nothing of an idea can be made into...
Can become anything.
Anything. Means,
you know, especially sure. when you're open to co-writing and you throw it and that first little thing turns into two things. And
it sticks with
you. And quite often we're our own worst critic. Right, you do need somebody to go, that's fucking great. Because you're like, oh, really? That's garbage. It's like, you're not your own best critic. But you can't be hyper-defensive about writing. You have to say, if somebody says, I don't feel it, then that's not a rejection of you as a person. You're not saying that you suck. Just saying that maybe there's another way. And find that invigorating, you know?
Because
this is a relationship that's developing musically, right?
Exactly.
Cool.
You always just stay positive, really, don't you? I mean, you... if an idea doesn't work, you try another one rather yeah. than yeah. dig into what was
and
wrong.
There, there's at least just, a part of it that's worthy, it. Right? There's like nothing is a bad idea.
No, yeah. exactly.
And right. I mean, even sometimes I find myself, I mean, not necessarily in this situation because we wrote seven songs and seven of yeah. those songs are on the record, but mm. I find sometimes I have to write a bad song.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I feel like sometimes it's just
you
something
need to
you
go
have
out
to get
with out. A loser to know when you got a winner.
Exactly, mm-hmm. right? Yeah. And I mean, it's just something that's kind of important in the writing process. If it's stuck in your head, and even though, you know, the hook line might be great, the words are,
yeah.
you know, the words mm-hmm. might suck, and then,
could
you know,
be flabby over here. I need a personal trainer to make me do some crunches yeah, when I'm not willing to do it.
It's still exorcism, isn't it? You have to get it out just to get it out yeah. sometimes.
For sure.
Yeah.
And it's, I think it's a release of whatever that topic
yeah.
might have been,
yeah.
right? I mean, whether, like you said, whether it was personal or a friend's experience or something that I'm yeah. just truly passionate about.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I just think it's all important.
Yeah.
It's all something that you can draw on later if it doesn't work out right now.
Yeah.
You know?
And I think it's great when artists come in and they explain how they write and why they write. And sometimes it does fall out of the sky. Sometimes you make a little trap and eventually the idea falls into it and it closes.
Yeah.
It's not always the same thing. But I think at the end of the day, having an idea that I need to write a song that is more than just a carriage for melody. You know, it really has to carry a message of great import. As Janis Joplin would say.
Sometimes you pull them kicking and screaming into the world, but it's worth
yeah.
the effort,
yes,
you know?
Yeah. Yeah,
but, and I appreciate the coyness. I appreciate wordplay. I, for one, do. That gets me hot. You know, when somebody, seriously, when somebody knows how to write, it's a great thing.
Great.
Cunning well, linguists, right? All right.
Yes.
We're going to do another live song. What are we going to do?
We're going to do
Chasing the Dark.
Chasing the Dark.
Chasing the Dark.
Song I wrote with Helen Weeks
all
shortly
right.
before Laura came over.
Yeah,
yeah, I'm sure Helen's yeah. going to appreciate when she checks this out on YouTube or
she's
listens to it on iTunes.
Yeah.
See that?
Cool.
Yeah.
Ah,
a little
nice.
Slutty. All right.
Nice.
All right. Hear it right here, right now, live, barbershoppodcast.com.
To be this way, I'm just treading water. Creatures in the corn flower blue, wires divide the view. The home star set sky. The velvet green of my dreams, and how will you end the show? The magnetic fields will pull, they want to keep me here for good. If I could find the will to break away, I could learn to swim.
Forever, the one, forever, chasing the dark.
Wonderful, wonderful music, wonderful recording. You can get yourself one of those at Boxo Studio. A big shout out to ourselves, start, because we don't do that enough, right? This is a studio. We make recordings here. If you've got a recording that you want to do, we'd be doing it. We'll give you a quote on almost anything. Ryan does videos. He's got a lot of those he can show you. Takes pictures. We do writing. We do promotion. We do artist services. We're in that business. If you are thinking about right now, who am I going to call? Call me. I'll let you know. And if I can't do it, I'll tell you where you go and who's cheap and who ain't. And if it's worth it or not, I'll share my experience because we're all in this together. All right. Laura Cole is in here with just wicked band, by the way. Nice little tight synergy you got going there.
I think I might keep him around.
Yeah, have you, Harvey, you get like experience working with Canadians before, or is this your first?
I had a friend at school who was Canadian, but this is my first musical experience with you guys. Yeah.
Well, they have to learn a rep because, you know, being all the you know, the colonies have a certain rep, right? And there was a whole bunch of us who were badasses in World War II, and so you know, the Canadians have a fairly honorable, good reputation as far as being musicians and comedians and people who are. You know, I don't know how to say this, like not Americans, you know.
Sure. It's
like because you would think you're right there. How could you not be? And yet it's like, wow, you know, you can kind of like somehow manage to maintain your identity next to that.
Canada is a country that's always interested me. I've always loved this part of the world. I've always wanted to come here. Finally, this is the first time I've been to Canada, but it's beautiful. It's great to be here doing this.
Yeah.
With people like this.
Exactly. And life is short. You got to go chase it and make it, live it, and make it happen, right?
Oh, totally.
And I imagine there's a lot of things that you could have easily talked yourself out of over the years that, you know, it's
which you should have talked
yourself out of. I'm asking your dad, which, because, you know, I've got two daughters, right? They're 8 and 11 now. But I remember the one when she was still in diapers, when she would run, like, she wouldn't even turn over her shoulder, right? Like, she was just gone, right? Was she always, like, incredibly independent and adventurous, or was Laura someone that you had to kind of, vis-a-vis what this industry takes?
She was definitely adventurous, and she never stopped singing. How's that?
Right.
And even in the car, so we would, instead of wondering if the kids could do something in the car when you're going to the cottage or something, we would say, let's play a new game called The Quiet Time.
You must have hated that game, eh?
I did.
So I lose this game every time.
But I figured out, I just had to say, I lose, and then I could just start.
Except, and that's a part that's a life lesson. How do you deal with failure, right? It's like, we will all recover. I lost The Quiet Game.
Hey.
So be it.
Yeah.
And should discontinue
singing. Yeah. It's so great. All right, we're going to play another cut off of this great CD, Humans. That's Harvey Summers and Laura Cole. It is Euphoria. What is, again, they're not to like about Euphoria. Is it, what's the song?
Album opener. So
was this the one that just started it all?
Sneaks up on you.
This but this one's a heavy track. It's it's so amazing.
We had fun with this. And a lot of these songs were recorded live as well. We had a great band in the studio. Danny Thompson on upright bass, and Liam Ginocchi on drums on this track, and Chris playing electric bass. So two basses. It was really nice to get that feel.
Yeah.
And then add the horns and stuff like that afterwards, you know. But
what city are you from?
I'm from Sussex.
And where are you living now?
Sussex. Bexhill in Sussex.
So, being a fan of Dan Lanois, you're aware of Hamilton. Did you have a preconception that it was like Manchester, or it had some sort of industrial vibe? Like, what was the read that you got on this city from someone across the pond?
Do you know, I didn't have any preconceptions, really. I knew a little bit about the area, about the steel industry and things like that, but I imagine that Hamilton would have a pretty strong musical community, which it certainly
any place that's
seem
gritty
to.
Has got to have.
Absolutely.
We eat our young here, and they're delicious. Right? But the poop that comes out is awesome, right? And like that stuff goes on to crush the world.
Yeah.
And it's true. Hot fire makes hard steel, and we make some damn hard steel. Sometimes we should be a little nicer. Where people should be like me, okay? It's not your thing. This is our thing. We're in this together. You know what? I got to give a shout out to our sponsor. I'm going on and on. I was talking about one of the people who helps us buy some beer every week. And that's going to be HamiltonArtists.ca. They have moved, and I don't even know. You know, they got a new location. I got to get on that. But you know where? You can ask them. Go to HamiltonArtists.ca. They are the kicking, buddinginest, mostest, bestest place to get something printed on something. They're a print shop. They do small things. They do big things. They do vinyl wraps. They do laser etching. The big things being mugs, and T-shirts, and hoodies. You got an image to get out. You got a name to get out. You got your band to get out. You got your dart team. You've got anything. This person is about music. They have custom wear. They build you a nudie suit. You know, I'm sure they'll make you one. You know, you can go up there just like Graham Parsons. And if you have an idea, and they're like me, right? You ask them if they can do it. If they can, they will. And they'll tell you how much. And if not, they'll tell you probably where you could go. And I don't mean that way either. They're very nice. HamiltonArtists.ca. Go check them out. 289-396-1653. All right. Back to the business of music. We're going to play this song, right? Yeah. We chatted about it, but we haven't played it.
Yeah. Well, I mean, just as a side note, it is basically the human instinct to have a euphoric time, essentially. Mm-hmm. I mean, everybody kind of searches for that vice.
Goddamn right. Some of us can hang on with our fingertips. Some of us fall off the edge. Some of us are too scared to even try. But once you've had it, there's nothing greater than euphoria on barbershoppodcast.com.
I wished I was a real boy. We'll be right back.
looking for bliss in this oral situation. I took the remedy in anticipation. Getting over your head, now what you gonna do? You let the sedative get a hold of you. It's a shame the antidote didn't work. Blame it on yourself, not the pharmacy clerk. It's good to finally meet you. I've been waiting for your call.
So great. The music, the people, everything that is Barbershop Podcast. We're just a little reflection on what's going on. But we do appreciate you coming by, supporting us, spread the joy, help us keep doing what we do. Love the haters. That's what I found work for me, you know? Mm-hmm. I mean, yes. I just wrap my arms around them and say, fuck you, like in the most wonderful, supportive way. You pathetic piece of shit, you know? But I... I mean it, you know, I do. And we just kind of keep doing what we do here at Barbershop Podcast, and the results speak for themselves. And again, I don't take any credit for it. It's funny because people will say, oh, I really like you. And it's like, well, I don't have no idea what I am on the show because I just fast forward through that shit and get to the music, right? Neither Ryan and I are, like our voices at all. Everyone's super self-critical. So that's kind of the quick question I'm going to ask. You got to overcome that fear, that anxiety, that self-criticism. For somebody who's either undergoing it or just for interest's sake, I want anyone, you know, to kind of pipe in on, like, what is the thing that keeps your confidence level and then your chops up? Because you've probably been like me, within the same phrase on the same song, you can go from being 10 feet tall to feeling like you just fell in a hole, because shit can happen, like, out of the blue. What's your, like, mental health trick to stay on top of the game?
It's almost, I mean, I guess I was trained early in sales, kind of. I mean, I just basically, you know, go for the sale, try it. Like, you know, even though you might get shot down 9 times out of 10, it doesn't mean that that one sale won't be like the best thing ever, right? Which is what I mean in regards to songwriting and stuff like that, is basically, you have to go for it. You have to take that shot in the dark. You have to express yourself the way that you feel you need to be expressed, right? And if it's truly your passion, then you will continue doing that.
Yeah, and that's going to refine on its own.
Exactly. Right?
What works and what doesn't, right? What about you, Harv?
Yeah. I don't know if you were asking about, you know, how it feels when you screw up when you're playing a song.
It could be a small thing, but more in the grand scheme of things, because it's a tough field. It's a tough business to be in. And people, no one wants to read your fucking diary. So you've got to somehow get these very emotional kind of snippets about who you are, make them into a world thing and drive it. And there's got to be many times where you don't want to do this.
Yeah.
What's your thing in music to keep going?
Well, from my perspective, I think every record I make, I always want it to be better than my last record. I always want to do something different, do something new, and make it better. Otherwise, what's the point, you know?
Are you a fair critic of yourself?
Absolutely. I'm a terrible critic. I'm never happy with anything.
Yeah.
Which is the point.
Which is the point.
Which is the point. And there's the old saying that you're only as good as your last piece of work. And for that reason alone, I think it's worth trying to make everything better. And I like to move into different areas musically, because I find, for me, that keeps it fresh and it keeps you on the toes. And, you know, you don't get into a rut. So it's always inspiring. And if it's inspiring, you hopefully
things
do
will,
a good
things
job.
Will, things
you
will, know? Yeah, things will yeah. sprout. Now, like, Rod, you strike me as kind of like a Davy Keon kind of a talented grinder. You know, it's like, you like keep your head down and things will happen through the result of good work. Like, how do you face music? How do you look at it as kind of a life force and, like, not?
I think what keeps you going kind of is the writing of songs and how I get really excited when you get a great idea and it comes together and then there's the next one and the next one, and you can't just wait and figure it's going to come to you. You've got to go and do it. And you got to keep going. You got to keep playing with people. You got to keep listening to different styles of music. Everything, when you put it all together, melts in your head, and you get new information to put out there and to take chances.
That's your drug, you're saying, right?
Pretty much.
It feeds it, right? And how about you, Chris? Like,
it's the same thing.
Yeah.
Like, you have to want to do it every day. And, you know, we're always, it's always thinking about it, either lying in bed, thinking about freaking shit, or you know, or ideas, or song, or anything. Yeah. It's all relatable, and like wanting to play, and like you mentioned, like keeping chops up and stuff like that is big. Like, we play and practice all the time, but it's because we want to. Like, we've been knackered since UK big time, but like still, we've still been playing every day, whether or not we've been performing or not. Yeah. And like to rehearse some stuff, go over it or whatever, like,
it's remarkable.
Ron's always playing, I'm always playing, Laura's always singing, Joe's always playing, Harvey's always playing or recording or doing something, you know?
Yeah.
It's always doing it.
Yeah.
It's and living I think, and breathing it.
Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah.
And for a drummer, like, it's not always easy to go down. I'm sure you can work on certain things or put the headphones on, but for you, the live, getting together, the live experience must be what it's about.
I try to really not take it too serious and really just enjoy you know, playing the music with the musicians. There's five people trying to think, like, with one, having one idea. And when it comes together, it's very gratifying. really is.
It is. Yeah. And we're going to get gratified right about now. What are you going to play for us, Miss Laura Cole?
What is next?
Risk Love.
Okay. Yeah. Anything you want to tell us about this one?
Yeah. I mean, I think, you know, being human is all about taking risks, really. I mean, this is a good sum up song, I think, for the record, besides Skeletons.
And it's kind of feel good tune, which is nice. You don't get many of those.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And it's just
the morbidity just couldn't keep its grip on this one.
Yeah, we were having too much fun. We couldn't fight back the misery. And yeah.
All right, love a good vibe. You're gonna hear it right now. Barbershoppodcast.com.
Safety net, and settling always somehow turns into a regret. You don't have to bet it all, but give a gamble, even if it won't leave you standing tall. Sift all the possibilities, and that leap of faith just might make you fall down to your knees. It doesn't have to turn out well. At the very least, you'll have a story to tell. What doesn't kill you makes you stronger. Play your part, get lost, go out and wander. Stars can't shine without the dark. Risk life, risk living.
Stops. Gotta love them. Barbershoppodcast.com. It is a wonderful experience every week, every Wednesday live, or you can check us out on YouTube, episode number 190 going down tonight, rocking and rolling. It is a wonderful thing to be part of it. I am privileged, and call it what you want. I just love rolling around like a hog in the slop and how much great music there is here in Hamilton. There's enough slop for all of us. This is the thing with a lot of times it's the same 100 people going out to all the shows. So I'm going to institute the month of July. We're going to have a contest, bring new meat to the market. All right. The person who brings the most people, new fans to a live music venue. We're talking your coworkers, your neighbors, your relatives, people who kind of look at you a little funny when you tell them that you go out. And you kind of want to keep your secret because it's cool people. There's only so much room in the club and there's stuff going on Monday too, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, there's something going on. So we're going to start hitting the community, get some prize packs or something together. But I want you to bring somebody new, you know, to a live music venue and show them what can happen. Because if something happens, it is, music is music, but the more you whittle it, the less impact that stick has when it hits you in the head. And there's nothing like going into a club or a music venue and experiencing live music, right? So quickly, first live show that you can remember or talk about legally. What was your first live music show?
Playing or watching?
Watching. The one that grabbed you went, oh my God, I want to do this.
Oh, interesting question. Because I grew up in a musical family, mm-hmm. so I was kind of watching my mm-hmm. parents play. They were in country bands, actually.
But there was a seismic shift at some point, obviously.
Yeah, well, I have to confess, I didn't want to do that. Yeah. They were doing it at the time.
Fucking weirdos.
Yeah.
Your mom's probably watching right now.
It was probably someone like the Eurythmics. It's cool. Annie Lennox and Dave yeah. Stewart. I thought they wrote great
so
songs.
So refreshing.
And it just was, it was real. It was pop music, but it had something about it.
Yeah. And you went to a show.
And a soulfulness. And
Yeah.
I was sold. Yeah. I wanted to do that.
Live show. Ron, what was your live music kind of shocker?
I think being dragged into the studio by Dan Lanwa to play on some of his early commercials and just enjoying it so much and saying, wow, this is so cool to be able to do things like this with other people and learning how to have to elevate your playing to make it right. And it just was such a joy, but it was really hard work and it was lots and lots of fun. And it just made you want to do it more and more and more.
Awesome. And you, live music kind of connection, what was the early one that was there?
Jeff Healey.
Jeff Healey, where was it? What was the venue?
It was somewhere in the late 90s or something. I was just a kid, but it was some free New Year's Eve show mm-hmm. at Niagara Falls area or some nonsense. And like the Nylons were playing too.
Yeah, they're a great band.
No, but Jeff Healey, he's playing and he stood up and he did his whole thing. And I was like, holy shit, who's this guy?
Yeah.
And that's what made me want to dig in for sure.
Yeah. I'm on you.
Mine was, I think it was probably 8 or 9 years old, and I went on a walkathon called Miles for Millions, and I saw Lighthouse play in this open field, and that kind of changed me forever. And I was watching all these people dancing to the music, and it just really really moved me.
It is transcendent. Yeah. When you're in a room and it has that kind of, when you're in a stadium watching a game with that crowd mentality, but you're still in your very individual place, and then the volume in the on a venue where it's moving air and it's physically invading your body, as opposed to being in control of it with your earbuds and having these little skinny MP3s as your reference. This is like, and to the degree in that live music can, and I don't want to say replicate, but absolutely sound as good, if not better, than recorded material. Now, sure, you got a lot of opportunities and time and money in the studio to make something thing, but I love, like, you can see what we're doing right here, okay? It's not a lot of instrumentation. Got acoustic guitar, got acoustic bass, got acoustic piano, and we got a small drum kit, and we got a voice, right? That's what it's all about. Strip it down to it, and it sounds, this wouldn't be out of place on a stage of any size. And again, that comes down to being very professional at what you do. We're going to do another one off of the Wicked CD, Daddy-O. How many times have I heard that? Anything you want to tell us about it?
Yes, it's a Harvey Summers.
Yeah, this is one that I wrote before Laura came over, and you might spot the influence, but I'd overheard Laura, and I think she was talking to you on this show last time you were on.
See, and you had mentioned the long-ranging influence of Barbershop Podcast.
This was an influence, and she said that her favourite song was At Last by Etta James, and that's been my favourite song, my favourite version of it for years. I've always loved those beautiful string arrangements all of those songs had. So I really wanted to do something with that kind of vibe and get the chance to write a nice arrangement for a song. It kind of came together in the lyrics. Well,
bit of a vamp.
You'll have to listen to him.
I'm already getting hot and bothered.
Make your own mind up.
Daddy-o.
It's the hardest vocal I've actually ever sung. Mm-hmm.
It was tough for the violinist.
I like the way this sounds. Yeah. Enough teasing. Daddy-o, right here, right now. Barbershoppodcast.com. Daddy-o. Love it. Barbershop Podcast. Get this record. It is human, and it is Harvey Summers, Laura Cole. Everyone's loving the show. My goodness. And you can watch it. You can watch it live, or you can watch it on YouTube. You can listen to it on iTunes. And go to barbershoppodcast.com, and there's a nifty write-up and all of them in there. Now, We're gabbing. We're kind of like stretching the show on. So we're gonna get more to the killer non-filler material, i.e. the music. What are you gonna do for us live? We're gonna jump right into it.
Yeah, we're gonna do this next one's called Redeemed, and there's actually another song on the record that we haven't played you, so you gotta check that one out.
Oh, I love
it. It's called Too Much Too Late, and I actually started writing that tune when I was mad at Chris.
Perfect.
And we finished it in the UK.
Yeah.
All together, and then I had to write,
the second half.
Song.
We call it the antidote song.
The antidote song. You know?
Yes. So, I love it.
Yeah, so I mean.
A story within a story.
Yeah.
God. All right, you're going to hear it right here, right now at barbershoppodcast.com.
You took me as a whole. You've given me love to live. Yeah, you have bound my soul. I'm suffering from lust. Only you can fulfill. And you taught me how to trust. Even against my will. In my provide hope in times of trial. There is no life without you. Although it took a while, I know you'd pull through. I've loved before, but it was never like this. And you were too hard to ignore. I was longing for your kiss. In my everything, every hope and every dream, sin has forgotten, and I am redeemed. My deliverance from sin, my salvation. Reaching to rid my shame, revoke on unlawful flame, in full esteem.
Sweet redemption, life. And it's a lot of times people because people tell me their shit. I've been open about my issues and dealing, and people tell me their stuff, and it's like, I'm saying, you write it, you put it in your songs. I mean, these are the stories of what, you know, and musicians, it's, I call it the wonderful jam. It's, they boil it down with sugar, they sweeten it up, and they make it thick and palatable and a jam, and these are life lessons. And that's why when someone fucks with that and writes inane, stupid music, it's time for the wood chipper. I just really feel that way. There can't be a lot of tolerance in the world for inane lyrics. It's like being like a doctor likes killing people. Like, it's like there's no room for that, you know?
I think I've got my new ringtone. Right? Soundbite there. Oh, yeah.
That's amazing. That's so well put.
You are photogenic. It is nice to see. But you're taken seriously musically. I want to ask you a little bit about being clearly it's getting better for female artists to be just viewed as artists. They don't have that cross to bear. But the same token, I get frontage and I get pressed because I'm pretty and I'm young. It's happened forever. It'll happen again in the future. doing videos, do you have like a general... Like, do you like doing them? Do you find that you can be yourself in your videos, or do you feel you have to cheesecake it up every time you do a video?
We haven't done too many, like, actual official music videos and stuff like that. But the ones that we have done, I do feel comfortable, for sure. I mean, I think it really depends on the team that you're working with, you know, as videographers and things like that, you know. We've had the pleasure of working with Michael Dismasic and Winnie Quinn as well, which was amazing. You know, they're so supportive. They're so high energy.
And very much believe in what they're doing and do it for the right reasons.
And they do it from the heart, just like we're doing.
Exactly.
You know, and I think that that's really important when it comes to videos, because...
Rid yourself of the vampires.
Yeah.
Those fucking people are everywhere. Surround yourself with the people who do it for the love, right?
Exactly.
And
for sure.
And your gut tells you who those people are.
I rely on my gut for a lot of things.
Yeah. Especially some shawarmas tonight.
Yeah.
All right. The video is called Skeletons. Is there anything you want to tell us about it? I've seen a little, I like it. It's great. What's the kind of thought process behind it?
I just think, you know what? It's basically a song saying that, you know, we are not, the chorus actually says we are not invincible by any means.
Human.
We're human.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
that's what Keith Richards says. Is like underneath our skin, our different colored skin or whatever, we all look the same.
Exactly.
People ask about
the
skull ring that he had.
Yeah, and I just think it's, you know, it's basically, you know, we're not perfect, right? Nobody's perfect.
And again, that person evolved that way to survive. You got to figure out a way to love that imperfect person. You're doing no disservice expecting somebody to reach your level of acceptance or perfection.
Absolutely.
And when you realize that about yourself, it's kind of, my dad used to call it like, you love yourself, warts and farts and all, right?
And all.
Yeah. And all. And that goes in there. All right. Here's a sweet video from Laura Cole, Skeletons, on barbershoppodcast.com.
Exactly who I am, that's only my business. More than meets the eye, below the surface. We're all striving for some sort of purpose. I'm all yours, if you're all mine. The floodgates are open, tell me is it divine? Well, I got passion, and yeah, I'm confident. I can live 2 months on a single compliment. Bones.
mountains. The past is the past, it's somewhat irrelevant. I'm flesh and blood with imagination. A dainty dame who never acts out of desperation.
I am not invincible by any means. I am human, the creator of all machines. I live my life, I make mistakes along the way. I don't give up, I'm not a sinner, not a saint.
Got to check it out. You know what I forgot to do? Give a shout out to our good friends at Taxes Done Right, because you probably forgot to do your taxes. You're a musician, you're lazy, you're sloppy, you got a whole bunch of shit, and it's like you work at it, you can get money from the government, right? And I got a way that you can get money from the government free, because you've been hiding it. You know, you get $500 a year just for being alive in this province. It's true. So if you haven't filed taxes, do it. Taxes Done Right, 529-6435. That's an old-time 905-er number. Late tax returns can still be filed. Avoid the costly penalties on late tax returns. Receive credit cards, refunds you deserve. Musician, artists all get a discount. Just say you know me. They will take care of you there. It's a good place. Taxes Done Right. It's on the tag. Go find them. Now, I have to say goodbye. It's like a sad thing because I could chat all night long. It's kind of cool because you were here like 90 weeks ago and so much has happened. Insane. Harvey was in England, didn't know you existed, and it's then true. Through Barbershop Podcast, know that you love Etta James, and you've all come back and fresh off the boat from Montreal. You didn't bring me any bagels or anything, but that's okay.
Poutine's in the car.
I hear it's not that great though, so I'll wait. I got one right by the car washer on the corner. It does a pretty good job. Thank you for coming in, playing sweet drums. Thank you for coming in, playing a sweet squeeze box. Nice meeting you. Keep up the good work. I love you people. I love you people. Love us back. Barbershop Podcast. Next week's going to be great. Like every week, barbershoppodcast.com.